Hello, my name is Matt Bowers, and I am a junior at Penn State University studying wildlife and fishery science with a minor in international agriculture. Today, I'm here to talk to you about human-wildlife conflicts in agriculture. So, when trying to understand human-wildlife conflicts in agriculture, it's important to know that species compete over resources. And by resources, I mean things like land, food, and water that are necessary for survival. Not only do wildlife species compete with one another, this could be intraspecific or within the same species, like two male deer fighting over a female or over a territory, but it can also be interspecific, which is between two or more different species. And they once again compete over things like the same food source or the same land area. But species also compete with humans too. And once again, it's over the same sort of resources like land and food. And this is where a lot of conflicts arise. Now, there are a lot of problems for humans that can be caused by wildlife. Wildlife can injure or kill livestock. They can spread disease to not only livestock, but also to humans. Wildlife can raid crops. They can harm the soil structure or landscape. This can be by stepping through agricultural land or digging or burrowing in human land areas. They can cause damage to homes and equipment. Think about rats or bugs getting inside your house. And they can also pose harm to humans that try to interfere. Wildlife is wild, and they can pose a lot of threats to humans if they try to get personally involved in the situation. When most people think of wildlife conflict, they usually picture mammals. However, a ton of human-wildlife conflicts in agriculture involve insects. And here's an example from Kenya.
They eat and destroy everything on their way. One swarm measured 60 kilometers long and 40 kilometers wide. Hundreds of thousands of acres of crops destroyed. People fight back with whatever means they have.
We are more than 200 herders here, and we all depend on this land for grazing. Now it will be disastrous if we all perish without getting any help.
The swarms came from Yemen, then down from the Red Sea to the Horn of Africa. The unusual warm temperatures off the coast are partly to blame. The recent heavy rainfall has created the perfect breeding conditions. The greenery that has sprung up is now fueling them. It has almost become a desperate battle.
And it is practically impossible or mockery to intelligence of humankind that this one can be used to control swarms of billions of insects that are destroying our crops and our crops and our pasture.
Agriculture is big business in the region. Here, the Kenyan national government is now increasing their efforts and spraying from the air. The swarms are spreading fast, up to 150 kilometers a day. The UN's Food and Agriculture Organization is raising the alarm, now calling for international assistance.
It's the worst that we've seen in Ethiopia, in Somalia in 25 years, and the worst that we've seen in Kenya in over 70 years.
The fear is that the locust numbers could increase 500 times in the next few months.
While wildlife can pose several problems for humans, the same can be said that humans can pose lots of problems for wildlife. Humans can take away habitat to be converted to agricultural land or grazing land. They can take away or reduce a species' native food and water sources. This can be through clearing habitat or through practices like irrigation. Humans can pollute waterways and soils that are essential for life through the use of herbicides and pesticides. They can fragment territories where either wildlife don't have enough land or there are barriers in their way of traveling or migrating to different areas of habitat. And some species can have territories or home ranges of tens to hundreds of miles, so this can pose a huge problem for those species. Humans can also provide new food sources that are abundant and easy to access. And while you might think this is positive for wildlife, it allows humans and wildlife to be in closer contact, which is where you get a lot of these conflicts. Finally, humans can kill, poison, or chase away wildlife if they interfere with their land, and this is a more direct form of conflict. Now, most of these problems for wildlife that I mentioned stem around a loss of land, and a prime example of this is in the Midwestern United States, where 720 million grassland birds have been lost since 1970, or over 50% of their population. In one specific species, the eastern meadowlark, 3 out of 4 individuals have been lost during this time span. And this loss of species almost directly correlates to the conversion of natural grassland habitat. Between 2009 and 2016, more than 53 million acres of land in the Great Plains has been converted to cropland. Now, 53 million acres is huge. Just to compare, the state of Pennsylvania is about 29 million acres. So think almost 2 Pennsylvanias of natural habitat have been lost within only 7 years. This creates a huge problem for wildlife when they're trying to survive. And when we're talking about the species loss, it's mainly due to industrial agriculture, or when you see rows upon rows of corn, soybeans, wheat, or even grazing land. And if you think about it, everything is connected in the natural world. If you lose one thing, like native plants, you're also going to negatively harm other parts of the ecosystem, such as soil microbes or insects or birds, mammals, reptiles, you name it. And a lot of scientists are saying that we're currently under the 6th mass extinction. Estimates show that as many as 100,000 species could be going extinct every single year. And these species provide benefits to humans too, specifically benefits to agriculture. Bees have been shown to provide a commercial value of over $15 billion annually in the U.S. A big part of this issue is that too often there is a sharp divide between agricultural land and native habitat. When you introduce agriculture to an area, a lot of times forested land is fragmented, as you can see to the image on the left. These little islands of forest are not enough for many species to survive. Or you even have instances to the right there where there's no trees, it's all fields and roads, and where do the wildlife go? Here's another example. This is a satellite image down in the Amazon rainforest, where deforestation and conversion of land to agriculture is immense. And the more and more that this land is taken away, the less area there is for wildlife to go. Here's another image. This is out in Kansas with irrigation circles. I don't see a single tree there, a single spot for wildlife to go, and a lot of species have lived there before the introduction of agriculture. So this sharp divide where there's agricultural land and no native habitat has really impacted wildlife and will continue to do so. Now, a solution to this problem involves the concept of wildlife corridors. And wildlife corridors are basically ways to connect native habitats together and reduce fragmentation. It can be something small and simple, like having an overpass over a highway, as you can see on the left, or it can involve larger tracts of land, like you see on the right, to provide relief to endless agricultural fields. When talking about birds again, something as simple as having shrub or tree borders to your property can provide some species with enough habitat to live and thrive. Another issue when it comes to human-wildlife conflicts in agriculture is policy, which is often a closed-off process. There is a wide gap between policymaking and planning and what actually takes place on the ground. This could be a lack of implementation by farmers or companies, or a lack of enforcement and monitoring of existing policies by officials. Policymakers don't really see for themselves what is happening. They're not down in the field personally experiencing this conflict. And there's also the slow pace of legislation, where an issue could intensify or completely change before it is addressed formally. Also, governments often choose a side. They will choose people over wildlife or wildlife over people instead of addressing both. And more often than not, they choose the former of these two. Also, corruption is big in some countries, which gets in the way of implementing policy. And there's also the influence of big industry, where the power of money is used to maintain unsustainable practices. One positive example in history of policy change related to this topic is with Rachel Carson, who was an environmentalist who addressed the negative impacts of DDT and other chemicals used by farmers in the 1960s. In her book Silent Spring, she discusses the harmful health effects to wildlife, farm animals, and humans when using these products.
There appears to be growing concern among scientists as to the possibility of dangerous long-range side effects from the widespread use of DDT and other pesticides. Have you considered asking the Public Health Service to take a closer look at this?
Yes, I know that they already are. I think particularly, of course, since Ms. Carson's book, but they are examining the matter.
Rachel Carson wrote this book about pesticide called Silent Spring in 1962. And it talked about the long-term impacts, the concept of latency and bioaccumulation, which were all new terms. Farm animals were dying with monotonous regularity because of pesticides. People didn't have any awareness that if a fish ate the bug that was poisoned by pesticides, that was going to end up in our bodies.
It touched a raw nerve among the American public.
The public was being asked to accept these chemicals and did not have the whole picture. So I set about to remedy the balance there.
The major claims in Miss Rachel Carson's book, Silent Spring, are gross distortions of the actual facts.
I mean, we talk about big oil. Well, there was big chemical. And Rachel Carson got under their skin because she was going to cut into their profits terribly.
She was attacked really viciously by Monsanto, and she was condemned pretty regularly as a spinster and a communist.
She got called off into this battle at a time when she was already in a fairly advanced stage of cancer.
The U.S. government went into a review of all of her data, and months later came out with a report basically backing Rachel Carson. She dies in 1964, just shortly after, with cancer. But if you have to make a Hall of Fame of people in the environmental movement, Rachel Carson is the game changer. She's number one.
By closing loopholes which permitted pesticides to be sold before they were fully tested, this bill safeguards the health of all Americans. I'm sorry the voice of Rachel Carson is still today. She would have been proud of this bill in this moment.
A solution in regards to policy is community-based conservation. There are many stakeholders that are involved in the policy-making process, and community-based conservation highlights participatory learning, or extension. This is basically where local farmers and community members work alongside scientists and researchers, as well as policymakers. Everybody gives their input, and in this process, things aren't one-sided or there's no closed-off approach. Everybody's working together. There's also the role of indigenous knowledge, which is highlighted in community-based conservation. Locals often know more about soil or how a crop behaves or weather patterns than the professionals do. So when it comes to wildlife policy, it should be a mix of protectionism, or making sure that the wildlife is conserved, community involvement, making sure that their voice is heard, public relations, making sure that everyone is aware of the issue and the possible ways to address it, conservation education, which is huge, making sure that everybody is educated on the issue and the potential policy, and finally, revenue sharing. One piece of legislature that addresses both agriculture and conservation is the Farm Bill in the U.S., which is passed around every 5 years and it is the largest source of funding for conservation of private lands. So you can see in the figure, around 7% of these billions of dollars goes towards conservation when addressing agriculture. Now, with the Farm Bill, you have voluntary conservation programs where farmers, ranchers, and forest owners work with the USDA to improve existing habitat, create new habitat, improve soil health, sequester carbon, and even address water quality and quantity issues. These programs offer solutions to farmers through cost sharing, technical advice, and land payments. Basically, you're incentivizing farmers to reduce the environmental impacts of their agricultural practices. In one such program, 4.4 million acres of sagebrush habitat were restored across 11 states between 2010 and 2014. Another positive example of policy is the Sustainable Development Goals, which were adopted at the 2015 United Nations Summit, and they are basically goals to make the planet more sustainable by 2030. Human-wildlife conflicts and agriculture fall under several of these goals. Sustainable Development Goal number 14 is Life Below Water, and I'm going to read this quote for you here. The expansion of protected areas for marine biodiversity and existing policies and treaties that encourage responsible use of ocean resources are still insufficient to combat the adverse effects of overfishing, growing ocean acidification due to climate change, and worsening coastal eutrophication. As billions of people depend on oceans for their livelihood and food source, and on the transboundary nature of oceans, increased efforts and interventions are needed to conserve and sustainably use ocean resources at all levels. Now, you would think that agriculture doesn't impact the oceans. However, just think about pollution, where pesticides or herbicides can be leached into streams, which eventually go into rivers and eventually accumulate in our oceans. Sustainable Development Goal number 15 is Life on Land. Land degradation continues, biodiversity loss is occurring at an alarming rate, and invasive species and the illicit poaching and trafficking of wildlife continue to thwart efforts to protect and restore vital ecosystems and species. Both land degradation and biodiversity loss are directly impacted by agriculture. Finally, Sustainable Development Goal number 2 is Zero Hunger. Hunger is on the rise again globally, and undernutrition continues to affect millions of children. Public investment in agriculture globally is declining. Small-scale food producers and family farmers require much greater support, and increased investment in infrastructure and technology for sustainable agriculture is urgently needed. Basically, how do you increase the quantity and quality of food to end hunger while not destroying entire ecosystems? There is a need globally for sustainable agriculture, which I will talk about a little bit later in this presentation. So I studied abroad in Tanzania and Kenya during the spring semester 2019, and I thought I'd include Tanzania as a case study since human-wildlife conflicts in agriculture are so huge there. So just as a little bit of a background, in Tanzania, agriculture is 25% of gross domestic product, and it employs about 75% of Tanzanians. Now, both of these values are much higher than, say, in the US, where agriculture is less than 2% of the labor force and around 1% of GDP. And another difference is that in Tanzania, most of this agriculture is small-scale farming, where it's families that farm primarily to feed themselves, and then they will also sell some of their product. Sometimes they don't even grow enough food to support their own selves and their families. This picture here is with Mama Tino, who I was able to stay with for a homestay and just kind of see how her and her family lived her life. And you can see her cornfield behind her with one of her cows there. Tourism is 17% of GDP, which is mostly wildlife and ecotourism. I had to put some proof that I was there, so you can see me in some safari vehicles. 28% of Tanzanian land is national parks, game reserves, and game-controlled areas. So this is a big portion of the country, and ecotourism provides a large economic incentive to conserve wild lands, which is great, but then you also have this issue where families still can't feed themselves. And then also there's the importance of indigenous knowledge and culture. Tanzania has around 120 tribes. This picture here, we were with the Dutoga tribe, which are primarily hunters and gatherers. And an issue for them is that they struggle to find places to go to hunt without having to interfere with agriculture or private land or protected wildlife areas. So, as I mentioned, there are a lot of human-wildlife conflict issues within Tanzania, and I thought I'd make a list of a few examples of these. First, you have crop raiding that can be done by elephants, buffalo, many bird species. Rodent species can damage crops or homes or possibly spread disease. Predators like hyenas, lions, and cheetahs can eat livestock. Typically, wildlife land is fragmented due to the demand for more crops and more food. Locals also have a general hatred towards most wildlife species due to the harm that they cause, and this conflicts with the very abundant ecotourism industry, which loves the wildlife and relies on them for a source of income. Also, you have this issue where people can get compensation for livestock killings or crop damage by certain wildlife. So farmers will often make up stories as an excuse to get money and or to have groups come out to try to kill the animal responsible. For example, you might have a goat that died of natural causes, but the owner will make it look like a cheetah did it so that they can try to get compensation. And then also there's the constraints of conserving wildlife among a resource-poor rural communities. And this goes back to the point of how do you balance helping humans and helping wildlife? So this video is just outside of Amboseli National Park in Kenya, right near the Tanzania border. You can see that there's a huge herd, but there's insufficient grazing land for them. Not to mention that they're in the habitat of lions and cheetahs and other wildlife that can cause harm. And so therefore this makes conflict almost inevitable. So here on the satellite image to your left, you can see Ngorongoro Conservation Area with Ngorongoro Crater right here, one of the biggest hotspots of wildlife in the whole entire world. And then you also have Lake Manyara National Park down here. Both of these are protected areas, but as you can see by the big red arrow, they're not really connected. There's this big line through here, this big area, where it's all developed land. It's mostly agriculture. And so you have this issue where species such as elephants, they like to travel between Lake Manyara National Park and Ngorongoro, back and forth. And in order to do that, they have to go through this developed land, which leads to a lot of human-wildlife conflicts. First, species have to go through Umtawambu, which is a growing town, and they have a lot of rice paddies, like you can see here, the top right. And species like elephant will plow right through those as they go on their way. Once you get past Umtawambu, then you have a road that you have to cross, which is another conflict. And you also have to go through all this agricultural land here, which you can see here in the bottom right about what it looks like. And so this again creates more conflicts as species travel back and forth between the two protected areas. But then wildlife is also motivated by tasty, easy food. And that's what this is in these areas, in these agricultural small-scale farming operations. The food is easy for wildlife to come and get, and the national parks aren't fenced in, and so you keep getting more and more conflicts in this area. This is a huge issue in this region. So keeping on track with the idea of elephants, here are some current methods used in Tanzania to deter elephants from agricultural land. First, you have chili fires, which act as an irritant. Basically, you make a fire, you put either chili peppers or flakes in there, which get into the smoke and disturb the elephant's eyes or trunk. In a similar way, you have chili fences and bee fences. Chili fences are, you can see on the image to the right, you basically take cloth, you soak it in, most times, motor oil and some sort of chili mixture, and that also acts as an irritant to elephants who get near it. Bee fences are pretty much what you think it is. You put beehives every few feet along a stretch of fence, and if an elephant tries to cross or if they try to barge through the fence, the bees will be disturbed and they will come and attack the elephants, which is intended to discourage them from coming by in the future. You also have chasing crews, where people will come out at night, and if they see an elephant trying to cross, they will scare them away. You have farmers that plant less tasty crops. Basically, they will plant crops that aren't the primary food source of elephants, and so therefore you're taking away their main motivation of coming into their land. And then finally, you have electric fences. Now, electric fences can be effective, but there's also this issue where elephants have been shown to outsmart electric fences, and I'm about to show you a video right here of one doing so. So you could see that right when that elephant tore down. So you could see that right when that elephant tore down the fence, it went straight to the food source, which is what it wanted that whole entire time. Now, elephants have also discovered that their tusks don't conduct electricity, so some elephants have been shown to be using their tusks to touch the electric fence and pull it out of the ground or move it out of the way, and I think that's really awesome of them. It's obviously not great for the farmers, but this is just another issue that they have to deal with. In Tanzania, community-based conservation is increasing. It's actually something that I learned a lot about while I was in the country. However, policymaking is still slow, and the Tanzanian government is very corrupt, which poses its own issues. Wildlife Management Areas, or WMAs, also exist in Tanzania and allow for the shared use of land between wildlife and pastoralists. These stakeholders share the benefits of revenue from conservation activities, and each village is allowed to identify its own development needs. WMAs don't necessarily stop conflict, but they do positively address the lack of grazing land that is frequent in Tanzania, and it creates a softer border between protected land and community land. This map here illustrates all of the protected land within Tanzania. First, you can see that it's a lot of landmass, which is good, and the wildlife management areas act like a wildlife corridor almost, connecting the national parks. This is great when it comes to conservation, but it doesn't really address agriculture as much and growing food insecurity within Tanzania. As I've discussed, there have been many improvements in Tanzania, such as by implementing WMAs, but there's still a lot of work that needs to be done. This leads to looking ahead. I think the main thing to take from this is that balance is critical. The needs of both people and wildlife need to be considered while trying to resolve these conflicts. You need to look at biodiversity, conservation, and evolution. Think about keystone species, species that are critical for the entire ecosystem to function, to allow for the whole circle of life, as you can see by the Lion King image. You also have to consider soil health. Diverse soil equals healthy soil. And traditional agriculture typically disrupts soil biodiversity via tillage. Also, animal behavior. Over time, species will evolve to be more comfortable around humans and around agricultural fields, the more that they're exposed to it, and this worsens the problem. Now you have to balance that with feeding a growing population. So you can see from the graph, population growth will eventually reach a point where we can't meet the nutritional needs of people. So then how do you produce more food or better quality food at the same rate that the population's growing? Well, one solution has been GMOs, but that has several pros and cons. One of the positives is that you can have more food and more nutritious food, such as by using biofortification, and these crops can also withstand more stress. However, there are cons, such as all the pollution that results from using more herbicides and more pesticides on these GMO crops. Also, food insecurity. This will continue to rise. So how do you meet that issue while also conserving wildlife? Finally, you need to balance those things with climate change in consideration. As the climate changes, so will ecosystems. Agricultural land and wildlife land will be lost, and you could expect to see increasing numbers of human-wildlife conflicts. So I think overall, this slide shows why this overarching issue matters. When looking ahead, you also need to understand that everyone plays a role. And here is everybody. You have government, such as the USDA, which is the U.S. Department of Agriculture, or the National Park Service, or the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, which make legislation, both in regards to agriculture and in regards to wildlife. You have small-scale farmers who are at the heart of the issue, really. They experience the most conflicts with wildlife when they're trying to grow their crops. You have large agricultural companies like Tyson or Bayer, and they have big influence. So changing their practices is a big change due to their size. You have the private sector. There are these things called B corporations, which are corporations that balance profit and purpose. Many of these have environmental initiatives in developing countries, which can help resolve some issues such as human-wildlife conflicts. You also have NGOs, or non-governmental organizations. These are grassroots operations that work with local communities to resolve issues such as human-wildlife conflicts in ag. And there are an example of two of them there. You have IGOs, or intergovernmental organizations, which can implement policy and education on an international scale regarding this issue. So they have a global role in human-wildlife conflicts. Finally, you have consumers. When people buy things, they are supporting a specific producer along with all of their positive and negative impacts on both the environment and agricultural processes. And don't just think about food with food consumers, but you also have clothing, think about cotton, and tourism, which often funds conservation activities that work to protect wildlife. Now, what you can do. If you're a farmer or someone you know is a farmer, you can take part in regenerative agriculture, otherwise known as sustainable agriculture. This focuses on soil health and biodiversity by implementing practices such as no-till, crop rotations, adding residue cover, or adding composted material to the soil. It benefits neighboring ecosystems and can even improve the water cycle, among other things. Next, stay educated. Do your research. Know what conflicts exist locally and what can be done to improve these conflicts. Along those lines, vote. Vote for officials who care about agriculture and sustainability and can implement policy that addresses these. Finally, shop right. This is about what I discussed earlier. You want to support sustainable farming operations or support conservation initiatives that can address both the wildlife side of things and agriculture side of things to make sure that this issue gets reduced and even resolved. Overall, what I discussed in this presentation is a huge issue, but yet you can still make a difference. Wildlife conservation and agriculture are two things that I am extremely passionate about, and they intertwine all the time, everywhere. I really hope you enjoyed this presentation, and I hope you're staying well during this crazy time. Thank you.